أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين. إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين. الحمد لله الذي وهب لي على الخبر إسماعيل وإيزاك إن ربي لسميع الدعاء. All praise belongs to Allah who has given me, despite my old age, Ismail and Isaac. Surely my Lord is the hearer of prayer. To our very respected Naib Umara, our beloved Mubalagin, national, regional, local Jamaat officers, and my beloved brothers and sisters, I greet you with the greetings of peace. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. It is a blessing to stand before you today at this 30th West Coast Jalsa Salana. My topic today is Allah listens to prayer. I humbly request your prayers that I might be able to address the topic adequately. In effort to do this, I hope to address the following several questions. One, what are the essentials of prayer to be accepted? Two, what are the etiquettes of prayer and the way of their acceptance? Three, what kinds of prayers are accepted? Inshallah, I will give some examples of the acceptance of prayers of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, signs and acceptance of prayers of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, and of his khulafa. The verse that I recited is Hazrat Ibrahim's exclamation of gratitude for Allah's answering his prayer. You may be familiar with some of the background relating to this verse. Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salam, had attained to very old age and he was without an heir. His fervent prayers were answered with the birth of his son Ismail when Ibrahim was 86 years old. The name Ismail literally means God heard his prayer. The younger son, Isaac, was born to his wife, Sarah, when Ibrahim, alayhi salam, was 99. Prophet Ibrahim was commanded by Allah Ta'ala to settle his son, Ismail, along with his wife, Hagar, in the Valley of Baca. The Quran describes it as, quote, an uncultivable valley near thy sacred house, close quote. It was at the time of Prophet Ibrahim's rebuilding the Kaaba that this verse relates. No doubt in his very advanced years, he was grateful to have Ismail to assist with this difficult task. But upon further reflection, his task was much more than simply the construction of a physical edifice. Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salam, a paragon of righteousness, was intent upon establishing the worship of the one true God and the banishment of idolatry. When a servant of the Almighty becomes far advanced into righteousness and is wholly dedicated to God, he achieves a condition of perfection in certainty, in hope, in fidelity, and in resolve, such that his trust in God is absolute and unyielding. His soul prostrates itself at the throne of the Almighty himself, and Allah moves toward fulfilling the purpose of the supplication and creates the means necessary for the fulfillment of that prayer. This is how miracles are fashioned by prayer. This was the condition of Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salam. This is how he was made the father of nations and the father of those who are devoted to God. Almighty God bestowed countless marvelous blessings upon Prophet Ibrahim through his righteousness, his sincerity, and his high resolve. Indeed, God heard his prayer, and through Ismail and Isaac, both of whom God exalted to the station of prophethood, the three great monotheistic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, were established. What a magnificent answer to prayer. Surely my Lord is the hearer of prayer. So what are the essential conditions and criteria for the acceptance of prayer? The dynamic of prayer is such that a mutually attractive relationship exists between a pious supplicant and his or her Lord. This relationship is based on the divine principle of Rahmaniyat, that is, Almighty Allah, through His mercy, draws a servant near to Him when, through the servant's steadfast obedience and sincerity, he advances in righteousness and approaches close to the Almighty. His prayer relationship takes on magnificent qualities, and his prayers are endowed with the ability to draw the Almighty toward them, such that God moves all the means necessary for the fulfillment of the prayer toward that end. That is God's mercy and His grace and His bounty to those who fulfill the requirements of prayer. What are these etiquettes and important elements of prayer? The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has instructed us to recite the Holy Quran during prayer with full understanding of its meaning and with complete attention and concentration. He encouraged that our supplications, in which we present our needs before the Almighty, should be in our own language. The kernel and essence of prayer is supplication, which should be done as a part of the prayer. Whatever we have to ask from God, we should ask Him during our prayers. We should always remember how essential it is to recite Surah Fatiha, as this is a perfect prayer taught to us by Almighty Allah, which comprises the proper etiquette of prayer and inspires the heart of the supplicant with eagerness. The promised Messiah has articulated the conditions of the acceptance of prayer. He says, quote, "Humility alone is not enough for prayer, but righteousness, purity, truthfulness, perfect certainty, perfect love, and perfect attention are all needed. It is also necessary that the object prayed for should not be opposed to the divine design for the welfare in this world or in the hereafter of the supplicant or of the one on whose behalf the supplication is made." He goes on to say, there are many other conditions in the absence of which prayer does not deserve the name, and so long as prayer is not inspired by full spirituality and there is not a close connection between him who supplicates and him in whose behalf supplication is made, there is little hope of the acceptance of prayer. Unless there is divine willingness for the acceptance of prayer, all these conditions are not fulfilled and full attention remains lacking, quote, close. He has also instructed us that when a prayer is offered in great tribulation, so that the soul melts and flows at the threshold of the divine, that is true prayer. And it is God's way that when such a prayer is offered, He accepts it and responds to it in some other manner. Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Al-Khamis has reminded us in the following manner. He said, "Fortunate are those who understand the philosophy of the acceptance of prayer and supplicate earnestly and profoundly, with full belief and trust in the existence of God, who has the power to accept prayers." He instructs us that the only way to seek help or guidance from Allah Almighty or to attain God's favor is for one to supplicate with all God-given faculties and energies and concentrate in earnest towards Allah. It is our experience, he says, that Allah Almighty accepts such prayers or guides the one who supplicates if the prayer cannot be accepted and grants him contentment of heart on the resolution of his prayer. The Holy Quran tells us, Uduni astajib lakum, that is, pray to me and I will answer your prayer. Within this short phrase is a kernel of wisdom, that to supplicate is human and to respond to supplication is divine. This relationship is perpetual, so that if we keep on asking, we will keep receiving. But our supplications must be sincere and determined. It is incumbent upon the supplicant to be steadfast in praying and not get tired or fall prey to despair that their prayer will not be answered and nothing will happen. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has compared praying to the act of sowing a seed by a farmer. Although the farmer buries the seed in fertile soil and under the proper conditions, it is not reasonable to expect that a tree will grow right away and immediately bear fruit. The farmer knows that he must be patient and steadfastly cultivate his plantings with the utmost care and conviction, that in due season his efforts will be rewarded and the object of his desire and expectation will become manifest. The same is true with prayer. It must be nurtured in the same way to bear the desired fruit. Those who are steadfast and persevere through the many stages of prayer arrive at their objective. Those who are hasty and those who relent and through despair give up only forfeit their objective. So, it is necessary that the supplicant should have sincere faith and with confidence should endure patiently whatever may beset him and should never despair that his prayer will not be accepted. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has said, quote, when God Almighty, who is benevolent and possesses majesty, sees that his humble servant has been prostrate at his threshold for a long time, he does not lead him to a bad end. Acceptance of prayer is of two types. One is as a trial, and the other as exaltation. The promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, has informed us that, quote, the condition of acceptance of prayer by exaltation is that the supplicant should be one of the elect of God Almighty, and the signs of his being one of the elect should appear in him in all directions, close quote. Prayers that are accepted by way of exaltation are the exclusive domain of those who, through their righteousness, truthfulness, and high resolve, have been honored to be the friends of God Almighty. Their prayers are of a very high degree and are related to great affairs, so their acceptance manifests wonderful and extraordinary events and establishes conclusively that these events are beyond the work and planning of man. Indeed, they are a special demonstration of divine power manifested in favor of his select ones who are informed by God Almighty of the acceptance of their prayers. The magnificent and exceptional qualities of prayer are manifested at the time of great trials. During times of overwhelming difficulty, those who enjoy exaltation are helped by God Almighty in marvelous ways as a result of their unyielding faith and their special relationship with God. These elect ones of God are the recipients of divine favors, and God becomes their friend and guardian in all matters. God is hidden behind a thousand veils, and these are the people who display his countenance. God is only recognized through prayers. It is through the miracle of the abundant acceptance of prayers of his elect ones that he displays his countenance. Allow me now to turn to some examples of the marvelous and miraculous acceptance of prayers of God's favorites and elect. In the second year of Hijrah, the fledgling Muslim community in Medina was threatened with annihilation from the Meccans, who had established and assembled a large army and was advancing toward Medina under the guise of protecting a caravan from Syria. The Meccan army was a force of 1,000 seasoned fighting men and 800 mounts, with 300 of their soldiers possessing armor. In stark contrast, the Muslims could only muster a force of 313 unskilled and inexperienced men and 30 mounts, with only two Muslims having armor at all. This extreme mismatch would seem to spell doom for the makeshift Muslim army. But the elect of Almighty God, the seal of the prophets, Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is God's beloved and whose prayers draw the extraordinary mercy of God Almighty, and along with every particle of the universe is drawn to his aid, and angels descend for his support, so no situation is helpless or hopeless. While the Meccans tried to gain every advantage over the Muslims, including taking up their position on firm land and leaving the Muslims to have to fight on sandy soil where their footing would be poor and their movements would be labored, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam spent the whole night praying the following prayer with great pathos. Quote, "My God, over the entire face of the earth just now, there are only 313 men who are devoted to thee and determined to establish thy worship. My God, if these 300 men die today at the hands of their enemy in this battle, who will be left to glorify thy name? Allahu Akbar." God heard the supplication of his prophet. Rain came overnight, which turned the tables. The sandy part of the field, which the Muslims occupied, became wet and solid. The dry part of the field, occupied by the Meccans, became muddy and slippery. During the night, the Prophet ﷺ had a clear intimation from God that important members of the enemy would meet their death. He even had individual names revealed to him. The spots at where they were to drop dead were also revealed. They died as they were named and dropped where they had been foretold. The Meccans were routed, a prophecy was fulfilled, and the might and majesty of Almighty God was manifest to the Muslims and the Meccans alike through the acceptance of the prayers of his chosen one, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We also can see copious signs of the acceptance of prayer in the life of the promised Messiah alayhi salam. One such sign of the acceptance of prayer was shown right here in the United States and was widely reported in the newspapers. At the beginning of the 20th century, Dr. John Alexander Dowie was an American clergyman who claimed that God had sent him as a prophet in the spirit and power of Elijah. He was the central figure of a charismatic Christian movement that captured the imagination of the American public and grew at a phenomenal pace. In 1902, he founded the city of Zion, Illinois, with the anticipation that it would become the headquarters city for his church. Dowie made repeated insults to the Prophet of Islam. The Boston Herald quoted him as saying in his journal, Leaves of Healing, quote, I pray to God for the day to come when the crescent shall disappear and may God destroy it. Close quote. Astaghfirullah. His insults to Islam and the Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam reached the promised Messiah, who challenged him to a prayer duel. Dawi's arrogant response was this, quote, "In India, there is a foolish Messiah who writes to me often telling me that the tomb of Jesus is in Kashmir. And the people sometimes say to me, why do you not reply to this, that, or other things? Reply? Do you think I should reply to these gnats and flies? If I put my foot on them, I would crush out their life. I give them a chance to fly away and live." Close quote. The promised Messiah stated his claim and prophesied as follows. Quote, "I am the true Messiah who was come in the last ages, was to come in the last ages. This has Almighty God spoken to me. I do not claim to be the promised Messiah by my own assertion, but Almighty God who made the earth and heaven has borne witness to the truth of my claim. If these simply are my words and there is no authority for them, then I am a liar. But God Almighty bears witness to my truth. If the pretender of Elijah's ship shows his willingness by any direct or indirect means to enter the list against me, he shall leave the world before my eyes with great sorrow and torment." This bold prophecy was made without concern that the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, was 66 years old at the time, while Dawi was only 55. The divine punishment began in 1903, and Dawi's misfortunes began to multiply. He started losing his popularity, and his moral stature was damaged by an expose of a female traveling companion and a lustful lifestyle. The financial soundness of his organization began to crumble, and it was discovered that he had embezzled over $2.5 million. Dawi's wife and son turned against him, and many of his followers began to desert him. He suffered two strokes in 1905, the second one leaving him completely crippled. His newly built city, Zion, was torn by dissension. John Alexander Dawi died the first week of March, 1907, in disgrace, misery, and helplessness. No less than 19 papers carried reports of this famous prayer duel. On June 23, 1907, the Boston Herald carried this headlines, quote, "Great is Mirza Ghulam Ahmed, the Messiah foretold, pathetic end of Dawi," close quote. How wonderfully are the prayers of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, answered as a mighty sign for Europe and America. In my lifetime, I have been witness to the miracles shown through the acceptance of prayer. In this regard, allow me to relate to you what I have seen and experienced. In 1974, the government of Pakistan embarked upon their persecution of Ahmadis, which reached its most cruel dimensions with the promulgation of Zia-Hawk's Ordinance 20 in 1984. The Ahmadis were tormented and persecuted continuously, and life was made unbearable for them, but they displayed an amazing steadfastness and spirit of sacrifice. The tortures perpetrated on peace-loving Ahmadis grew even harsher. Some two dozen Ahmadis were martyred. The holy founder of the Ahmadiyya movement was subjected to slander and blasphemous allegations. Profane and foul language was used against other venerable persons of the Jamaat. Some dirty propaganda is spread throughout the world, and the Jamaat's cogent and articulate refutations of these false charges were ignored. All efforts of their reformation having failed, all precepts falling on deaf ears, warning of divine punishments unheeded, and having exhausted every other avenue, Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmed Khalifatul Masih Rabi, Rahimatullah Ta'ala, on June 10th, 1988, challenged all their top leaders for a mubahala, a prayer duel. Let the matter be judged by Allah, the best of judges. 1 month after the challenge of mubahala, Maulvi Aslam Qureshi, who had gone underground capriciously, suddenly reappeared. It had been alleged that he had been abducted and then murdered, and the name of the head of the Ahmadiyya community was maliciously implicated. Aslam Qureshi's appearance was an ignominious disgrace for their opponents. After giving Zia-ul-Haq Sahib some time to respond, when it became evident that there was an upsurge in the persecution of Ahmadis in Pakistan, the Imam of the Ahmadiyya community, at last, in his Friday sermon of August 12, 1988, in clear words, announced that because General Zia-ul-Haq, by virtue of his conduct, accepted the mubahala challenge and instead of turning away from the acts of cruelty, precipitated them, he cannot therefore, under any circumstances, escape the wrath of God Almighty, and decreed afflictions of mubahala will definitely strike him within a matter of days. After the sermon of August 12, 1988, General Zia-ul-Haq, together with some of his key military colleagues, including the American ambassador and the CIA representative in Pakistan, perished in a horrifying air crash. The might and majesty of God was once again manifest, and the acceptance of prayer dramatically demonstrated. Oh, my beloved brothers and sisters, as I conclude my presentation, know assuredly that God is ever near and he hears and answers prayers. In the end, all praise belongs to Allah, Lord of all the worlds. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.